The reading from Deuteronomy is about the process of deciding who speaks with authority. The voice of Moses is saying that prophets will come to the people, but so will false prophets. It's an ongoing problem then, and it's an ongoing problem now. In another reading, a little farther on, the voice of Moses says, "You may say to yourself, how can we recognize a word that the Lord has not spoken? If a prophet speaks in the name of the Lord, but the thing does not take place or prove true, it is a word that the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken it presumptuously. Do not be frightened by it. Do not be awed by it." Let us now reflect on the ministry of the Reverend Harold Camping. Here's a recap from CNN. For months in early 2011, Camping predicted that Jesus Christ would return to the earth on May 21st of 2011, and that a select 2-3% of the world's population would be raptured or taken to heaven. By the way, the word rapture does not appear in the book of Revelation. When his May 21st prediction failed to pan out, Camping took to the radio airwaves to say he had misinterpreted the nature of the rapture, but that the world would still end on October 21st. Those left behind would face months of tribulation before perishing in the earth's destruction. The following year, Camping admitted he was wrong and said he was getting out of the forecasting business. Camping had founded Family Radio, a nonprofit Christian radio network with about 65 stations across the country in 1958. It received $80 million in contributions between 2005 and 2009. That's $20 million a year. He first inaccurately predicted the world would end in 1994. Despite his poor track record, he had gathered many followers. Some gave up their homes, entire life savings, and jobs because they believed the world was ending. Here ends the reading from CNN. There is nothing we can do to prevent preachers like this, but we can do something to counter it, which is to speak up against it. We can preach against it. The Christian community has long had a habit of not speaking against another Christian denomination. It's considered bad form, inside baseball, not a public thing. It's bad for cats all over. That's all well and good until the stakes get raised. The stakes are now raised. Crushing the Environmental Protection Agency, which was founded by Richard Nixon, is an act of fundamentalist anti-science beliefs. A distinct rise in violence against the LGBTQ community is Christian homophobia, and the moving of the American embassy to Jerusalem are all examples of biblical prophecy misinterpreted to a degree which is no longer in-house hair splitting, but potential shifts in policy driven by fundamentalist theology that is easily debunked by any moderately serious Bible scholar. But they also create permanent and serious damage to the rest of us in the meantime. We have to discern the effectiveness of a prophet by what they say and do. We learn that as Samuel grew, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. Now, the Reverend Harold Camping's words fell to the ground, but not before his radio audience coughed up $80 million. He gave up forecasting, but he didn't give up broadcasting. And a credulous audience that believes you can't say it on the radio if it isn't true continues to be bamboozled by the prophet-minded prophet. Diana Butler Bass is a leading national writer about the shape of the modern Christian world. She's a progressive Episcopalian reporter. When she heard that the embassy in Tel Aviv was going to be moved to Jerusalem, she thought, biblical prophecy. Her upbringing in a Bible church is described like this. We read the Bible all the time. in personal Bible study and evening Bible classes. We listened to hour-long Sunday morning sermons. For us, the Bible was not just a guide to piety, it also revealed God's plan for history. Through it, we learned how God had worked in the past and what God would do in the future. For many conservative evangelicals, Jerusalem is not about politics. It is not about peace plans or Palestinians or two-state solutions. It's about prophecy. And most certainly, it is about the end times. She continues, God still loved the Jews, he told us, and wanted to redeem them. Thus, absent the church, the Jews would experience a great religious rebirth and rebuild their temple in Jerusalem. This would spark a series of cataclysmic events that would culminate in the Battle of Armageddon, the last war of humanity. But it would also cause the Jews to finally accept Jesus as their Savior. After all this occurred, Jesus would return in glory and God's kingdom and a 1,000-year reign of peace, and it would begin in Jerusalem. This theology, a literal belief that all these things must happen before Jesus will return to reign on earth, is called dispensational premillennialism. And it is not a quirky opinion of some isolated church. Although the majority of Christians do not share these views, versions of dispensational premillennialism dominate American evangelicalism, end quote. And they dominate the political system now. 81% voted for the current administration. They believe they can help bring about the millennium by moving the American embassy to Jerusalem. For me, these prophets speak words that fall to the ground. This is about believing they are right and everyone else is wrong and doomed and bad. It's also called exclusivism, as in, we are the only ones who have the exclusive truth. And we are excluding anyone who disagrees with us. Like an exclusive restaurant, we have ways of keeping you out. So we have to disabuse ourselves of this idea that all the prophets spoke in the past, that they are all in the Bible, and that that kind of thing is over and done. There are prophets now. There are false prophets now, and there are also true prophets. True prophets that still speak with authority. False prophets talk in terms of magic, that the Bible can predict the future. True prophets talk about the reality of our situation and what our role is, what our responsibility is, and call us to live up to our own standards. The Reverend Dr. King is one of those. He speaks with authority. Pope Francis seems to be one of them mostly. Not always, says the Protestant. But when he said, we pray for the poor and then we go feed them, that's how prayer works. That is also how a prophet works. Let's move into the story from Mark. First, when they say Jesus speaks with authority, what does that mean exactly? Let's compare him to who else would be teaching in his time. The scribes are the guys who work on copying over the books of the Bible and also the commentary. So they can speak with authority about what is in there. The Pharisees, which means separatists, were a party that emerged largely out of a group of scribes and sages. Their name comes from the Hebrew word, the Hebrew and Aramaic word, parushi, Pharisee, parushi, which means one who is separated. It may refer to their separation from Gentiles, the non-Jews, who are sources of ritual impurity, or from irreligious Jews, which is how they saw the Sadducees, who ran the temple. Pharisees were distinguished by a strict observance of the traditional and written law and commonly held to having higher standards or a superior sanctity to civilians. They were experts on the rules, and they wanted people to be strict about the rules like they were. Their authority came from their expertise in the laws dealing with human behavior. and they were quick to condemn those who did not follow the letter of the law, but they did not interpret. But Jesus did interpret and extrapolate from the text. We've heard this before in Matthew 5. Jesus said, "You have heard that it is said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you." So Jesus holds the people to a higher standard. He expands on what the teachings are. Jesus interprets. He adds his insight to the common understanding. He does the same with John the Baptist. John says, "If you have two coats, give one to the poor." But Jesus says in Matthew 5:40, "If anyone wants to take your coat, give him your cloak as well." That doesn't leave you with much. Jesus is an extremist for love. Extremist for love. He takes the teachings of generosity and expands it. He takes the love of God that God has for the Jews and expands it and gives it to the Gentiles. That's us. When Jesus speaks with authority, he is giving the text his own reading, his own interpretation. By everything we have on him, Jesus was well acquainted with the Hebrew Bible and therefore could teach beyond it. He could expand upon it. We are called to do the same. I am as a teaching elder, and you are as disciples of the Christ. You learn, you work towards an understanding of the Bible, and then you speak the truth as you understand it, when you are comfortable that you know what the situation calls for. There's a Jewish saying from the book The Chosen: knowledge that is not shared and used is wasted. You have to bring what you know to bear. The seventh circle of hell, according to Dante, is reserved for those who did not say anything. Speaking with authority means you understand what a particular text is about and you interpret it. Your knowledge does not have to be perfect, and you do not have to be perfect. You don't have to even quote the Bible. We just have to have the courage of our convictions and speak. Take the leap of faith. In Luke 12:11, we hear this: "Do not worry about how you are to defend yourselves or what you are to say. The Holy Spirit will teach you at the very hour what you ought to say." It is our silence that is killing us now. Now, on to the exorcism. Exorcisms happen. I took two classes from the Reverend Dr. Paul Berge at Luther Seminary. He's a graduate of St. Olaf College in Northfield. He earned a Bachelor of Divinity degree from Luther Seminary in 1963, and both a theology master's and doctor of theology degrees from Union Theological Presbyterian Seminary in Virginia. He was also a research fellow at Yale Divinity School in 1979 and visiting professor of New Testament at the Lutheran Theological Seminary in Fianarantsoa, Madagascar, in 1986. He taught for many years at Luther and became a dean. I took two classes from him. We talked about exorcisms once after class, and he said, "I don't have any problem at all understanding Satan as a living presence in this world. I helped preside at 8 exorcisms in my time in Madagascar." So, that's good enough for me. This demon possession in Mark may have been an epileptic seizure, or it may have been a person with schizophrenia, or it might have been Jesus casting out demons. Any of those are possible. We will never know. That's why it's called faith. But exorcisms should not be tossed out as an exaggeration or a fairy tale. They still happen. The movie The Exorcist is based on a real-life Lutheran pastor who cast out a demon from a teenage girl in Washington, D.C. Let's also look at the metaphorical content of this passage, even if it is a historically validated event in real life. The community that heard Mark's gospel was powerless and poor in a country occupied by a powerful empire, the Romans. The theological imagination of the victory of God's power over illness, disability, and danger was for them life-saving good news. The ancient worldview that attributes illness to unclean spirits that lies behind this story does dramatize forces that wreak havoc within individuals, communities, and countries. Mental illness, addiction, sexual abuse, and racial hatred. The gospel proclaims Jesus has authority over even the most unclean of spirits that continue to take us over. We think we are modern, but there are many people, especially Christians, who think poor people are poor because they are lazy, or undisciplined, or just plain evil, just plain bad. They think a homeless person, homeless people, are homeless for the same reason. It's like saying to old people with bad vision that they should have saved up their vision from when they were younger. We don't want to help those people because they spent all their money on booze and women and movies, and we should never give them something for nothing. Like, we should not help them out of being homeless until they have some money. But if they had the money, we would not need to help them. It's shocking to me that this has to be spelled out to grown-up elected officials. The missions of Jesus include teaching, healing, and feeding. Those core missions are core missions that we should support. Teaching, healing, and feeding. Sometimes I feel like those who cut government funding for social programs do so to keep religious communities from advocating for deeper social justice issues because we're too busy. Issues like our overstuffed prisons, or lack of affordable housing, or an underfunded judiciary. So in our world, we have the chance, the opportunity, to go out and make our voices heard. We have the opportunity to speak truth to power, to make our city, our county, and our state into effective means of creating justice. Justice does not occur in nature. We have to create it. When we are confronted by the arguments of the power structure, remember, they are always going to fight back because they have a stranglehold on the system that gives them power and authority and wealth and comfort. We must speak up. When the disciples told Jesus there were 5,000 people here and they were hungry, Jesus said, "You feed them." Now we tell God there are people who hunger for the truth, who need prophets to speak to them. And maybe God says, "You speak to them." Let us pray. Dear God, our Creator, you gave us Jesus, who taught us, who fed the hungry, who healed the sick, the infirm, and those entrapped in the grip of evil powers. You ask us to follow you, not with mere belief, but with a commitment to do your work in our time, as Jesus did in his. Help us to speak up, to loosen our tongues, to be brave in conversations with those we know, in letters to the editor, in how we vote, and in whom we elect. Help us to remember what is said dozens of times in the Bible: do not be afraid. Fear not. Let us worry instead, of what happens if we remain silent to protect ourselves. All this we ask in your name. Amen.